Good evening everyone, my name is Krishnaveni Kalne. I am a psychologist working with Neurogen and I am also a member of Asha Ekho. A topic that we are going to discuss about today is very well known to each and every one of us, something called as anger management. There is no individual in this world who doesn't understand anger. Anger can be experienced by all individuals, from the youngest of youngest kid to the oldest of oldest one. Anger is one of the most primitive and basic emotion that is experienced across every one of us. For our understanding, we can try and categorize anger into three types of anger, just for our own understanding. Anger towards others, this is anger that we show towards other people, whether we are getting, when we are, you know, increasing our volume, yelling at them, throwing things at them, or, you know, any situation where you feel that you have to direct anger towards others. Anger towards self is when we feel angry towards ourselves for not being able to fulfill the task that we wanted to achieve. Certain aspects that we wanted to do and we were unable to do so for whatsoever reason. Or the discrepancy between your own ideal self and where you are right now. All of these could be anger towards self, and it can manifest in many different ways. The third type, something not all of us would know about, is constructive anger. This is a type of anger that really brings in that motivation and that energy level in you to bring about a change. Whenever somebody feels angry, you can see the sudden surge in own energy level. And this energy can be converted into bring about some positive change, either for the individual or for the people around them, for the environment or the societal changes. And this is known as a constructive anger. While we don't have to know a lot in about the theory aspects of anger, but knowing the basics about what is anger and how it can affect us really can help in identifying them better and managing them better. And thus, it is very crucial when it comes to anger management. When it comes to motor neuron disorders, one of the root causes of anger could be the frustration related with the medical diagnosis in itself or the illness in itself due to its restrictive nature. It can be either from the caregiver point of view or it could be from the patient point of view. But the root causes that we often have identified tends to be due to the frustration related to the illness, the disappointment either with the medical system for not being able to get adequate medical treatment, or due to the lack of research in the field, or due to lack of availability of cure and medications to individuals with MND. Judgment about own self, judgment about the environment, or about how other people are perceiving me. All these things can bring about anger for an individual with MND. A rejection in terms of not being able to perform how you were performing before, to now the restricted lifestyle that you could be leading. Rejection may be from family members, from the society, from your job place, could be one of the root causes for anger. Fear is another root cause about what's going to happen in the future, what's going to happen to my family members. What about the financial aspects? When we talk about an individual's health, it's always personal, occupation, social, mental health and physical health. All of this contributes to an individual's complete health. So any fear that is specific to any of these aspects, it can bring in anger to any individual. Negative thoughts. When things may not go our way, it's quite normal for us to have certain negative thoughts about the future or about ourselves or about people around us. This can also trigger anger. Why do we need to manage anger? Anger, something when used constructively can really bring about a very good positive change. Some examples I can give with regards to social reformations would be Gandhiji when he tried to, you know, bring that anger and bring about the changes in our country. Nelson Mandela for his community, right? These are very good examples of constructive anger where anger was directed for a positive change. But when anger goes unmanaged, or when anger has been there for a long time, or it's a chronic anger, it can really affect our physical health, our mental health, our social life, and our occupation. How does it affect our physical health? Now, some of you might really find it fascinating that when we get angry, for that momentary time, our brain goes under fight and flight mode, which in turn triggers our stress response in our body, making our brain release cortisols. Now, cortisols affect two major areas in our brain. This happens momentarily when we are angry, the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus. The prefrontal cortex is a part of brain that helps us in making judgment. And that is why when we are angry, we can't think clearly and we may feel that we are not able to make a proper decision. That's why they always say, never make a decision when you are angry. Because in anger, our brain's ability to make judgment is affected. The other part of the brain that is affected is the hippocampus. Now, hippocampus is known for learning and memory. When we get momentarily angry, our short-term memory gets affected and it also prevents us from making new memories. And this is why in anger or when you're having a heated argument, you may forget what you had to say next. Now, this is how anger can really affect our brain and stop us from functioning at our best version at that moment. That's why we may do things that we usually won't do otherwise, like maybe raising our voice, throwing things at someone, getting violent, or using words that we would never use for people otherwise. Stress is another physical, another aspect that is triggered due to anger. Our body can feel very stressed when we get angry because of the fight and flight mode being activated. Now over here, what happens is when we get stressed, our body's immunity system weakens. This means that you're going to be more prone to infections and ailments. It also reduces your ability to tolerate pain when we are stressed. So anger affects stress. Stress, prevents us from enjoying life at the maximum possible way. Especially in chronic illnesses, it is ideal that we have to keep our immunity high and also ensure that our stress levels are low. When a person gets angry over and over again towards self or towards others, it can really put their stress level at high within the body, thus affecting us physically as well. Stress or anger through stress again can affect our blood pressure. We are at high risk of stroke and cardiac arrest, and it can induce headache, which can affect our day-to-day living too. Anger has a tendency to affect our mental health too. We are very well aware of the stress, the ill effects of stress on anybody. The anxiety can go up. A person who is always angry can feel anxious around different areas of their life, and every day can seem challenging for them. An individual who is already facing or having grief with regard to the illness, or the caregiver who is already overburdened with a certain, depressive symptoms, can get aggravated further when they are always angry. And insomnia. We all know the importance of sleep, which plays a very important role in our mental health and our physical health. Insomnia can be further worsened when an individual is chronically angry. Social life. So, you have a conversation with your family members, it ends up getting into a heated conversation. You say things that you may not otherwise say. you kind of have a conflict over there with family members and your loved ones and maybe your friends also. This in turn can make you further angry, and it can prevent you from having a good relationship with them. You may avoid going and meeting them, or you may avoid interacting with them due to your anger issues. Nobody wants to talk to or interact much with people who get angry often. So it affects our social life too. Occupation. With MND and ALS and the caregivers of MND and ALS, there is a chance you're already working, working really hard on a day-to-day basis towards your health. And the caregiver may be managing multiple aspects of their life by ensuring that they are providing the maximum care that they can provide to the patient. But when other areas are affected, maybe with the physical health, the mental health and the social health, it's obviously going to spill over onto our occupation. Whether you're working for someone or if you run your own business, either way, your best judgment can be affected when you get angry, because of its ill effects on our body. So we know how it affects. What happens when we do actually engage in anger management is that we get certain benefits out of it, and that could be definitely first and foremost would be improve emotional and mental health. So that means that you will be able to make judgments better, you will be able to regulate your emotions better, you will be able to form better relationship with your family members, thus ensuring your whole family has a harmonious environment. And I think that is what we all are going towards, is to have a better life in the end of the day, in any way possible. And if COVID has taught us something, is to have a happy life is something that we all are aiming towards. You will have a better interpersonal relationship with people you meet. You will be able to form better rapport with people. Your chances of getting infections and other medical conditions that are associated with anger gets reduced. So, the enough perks for me to engage in anger management. Now, we did discuss about what are the benefits of doing it and why we should do it. Let's focus on how do we identify when somebody is getting angry. To identify anger, there are four main aspects that you can look at. It can manifest into physical cues, it can manifest into behavioral cues, it can manifest into emotional cues, or it can manifest into cognitive or your thought processes. Let's just take an example over here. When it is a physical cue, it could be a rapid heartbeat. You may feel like your BP is rising. Often people synonymously use this word that my BP is rising now, I can't handle with this. Tightness in chest, difficulty in breathing, or you could be doing shallow breathing when you're angry. These could be a symptom that you're really angry at that moment. You may feel hot or a flushed kind of experience in your body. A raise in your temperature could be experienced when you're angry. Behaviorally, maybe other people will observe, it can cloud our judgment, so we may not be able to definitely observe, but other people may say that you were clenching your fist, or you were raising your voice, or you were just staring away, you're like, I don't want to talk to you. These kind of things can be seen behaviorally. So these are times when you have to take a look into your anger. Emotionally, it could be an underline, or it could be seen as secondary to anger. You might exhibit fear, you may exhibit hurt or jealousy or guilt. Any of these emotions can be seen instead of anger, but the manifestation could begin from anger in itself. The cognitive thoughts. You may have very hostile self-talk. You may have images of aggression and violence, and you may feel better about having these kind of thoughts. Now, these are some of the cues that means you are getting really angry in a particular situation. So I know the cues. We know that, okay, these are the things that could really, that is the reason why I could be getting angry. We saw the physical, the mental, the cognitive, the emotional. Yes. Now what do we do? In any situation, what you can do is rate your anger from 0 to 10. where 0 means no anger and 10 means really angry as an individual, right? So over here, you can do this in the moment if you are able to do it. If not, I would suggest just look back at a moment when you were really angry and try to recollect that moment when you were feeling very angry and rate that on a scale of 0 to 10. 0 means no anger, or 10 means really high anger. Anytime you feel that your anger scale is going towards 5 or 6, that's when we have to start intervening, not when it comes to 10. Because 10 means it's already very high, the anger, you know, meter has already gone beyond. We have to start managing our anger when we reach 5 and 6. That time we will still be able to manage it better. Now, looking into the strategies of anger management, certain things that you can do immediately in the moment is you can take 10 deep breaths. Now, before we just started the webinar, there was a small technical glitch and everyone involved in this, they're getting little, you know, angry, and it's quite obvious. We were practicing it ourselves and I can tell you it did work. Okay, so 10 deep breaths. It really stops you at that moment, grounds you to the moment, helps you calm down. You can count backwards from 20 to 1, like 20, 19, 18, 17, 16, 15, like that. Or you could subtract 4 out of 100 and keep subtracting till you come to the minimum amount possible, like 96, 92, like that. Time out. So you're having a heated argument, you're having an argument or a fight with your loved one or with anybody, and you're not able to manage it at that moment, you can always ask for a timeout or give timeout to the other person. Wherein you just tell the person in front of you that, you know what, let's discuss this a little later. You can take timeout for 1 minute, 30 seconds, 1 hour, 2 hour, 1 day. It depends on you. Till you are able to put forth your point without getting angry. And just the information that you have to pass on can be passed on. Timeout is a very wonderful technique for especially extreme anger, heated conversations and anger-inducing moments. But it comes with some practice, and all of these techniques will come with a little practice. Now, these three things can be done immediately in a moment. If you can take it a little forward, is you can avoid certain black or white sentences. It's in very famous English media, idiom for all right or all wrong. A glass can be half empty as well as half full. That is what this translates to, black or white sentences. Try and meddle in between the gray area of making sentences. Instead of saying that I'm always right, this person is always wrong, or I'm always wrong and this person is always right, try to think at whether even they are also right at that moment. That will reduce your anger by half at least, giving everyone a benefit of doubt basically. One of an example of black or white sentences that I can think of is, a caregiver may think that, you know, I am doing all this for my, you know, for the person you are taking care of, for he or she, but she never takes or he never takes in efforts to take steps towards better health. Now, what happened over here is the caregiver may feel that the person never does it, which may not be true. The patient may be feeling, may be having feelings of getting better health, may be really looking forward to getting better. So by saying an individual does things never and always, this is kind of an absolute sentences or words that we use, which can put too much pressure on the communication that we are trying to convey, or the material that we are trying to convey, and making it generalized towards all the time, which may not always be true, thus inducing anger thoughts and the feeling of anger more. Like, a patient may think or say that everyone I meet is pitying me, or they are over sympathetic towards me, which may not always be true. Like, someone might be just really concerned that you want, you know, for you, and may just try and help you out in any way that they can. So avoid absolute words such as never and always. Now, some techniques that we can do immediately, but not everything we can do immediately. Right? So, what can you do on a daily basis? What you can do on a daily basis is start with a gratitude log. I think everybody must have told you this. Everyone in the positive psychology field, your parents, people you know might be saying, you know what, write a gratitude log or maintain a gratitude log. But it can be little difficult, and it can be little difficult to be consistent with it when you're doing it. So I'm going to give you some basic techniques. You can try it out. Five things that you're grateful for or you're thankful for in that day. And this has to be done every day. You can write it down if you can. You can video record it. You can audio record it. Or you can just recollect if you are somebody who will not be able to do the other things. This recollection can be done either early in the morning when you wake up or at the end of the day before you go to sleep. Now, gratitude log. So let me tell you, sometimes the day can seem like there's nothing to be thankful for. Just out of the top of my head, I can think of three things, and I think I'm really thankful for this knowledge that I have that I'm able to share with all of you. I'm really thankful for this Wi-Fi, this beautiful technology where I'm sitting in one corner of India and maybe our people from outside the country are able to see. I'm thankful for this beautiful team over here who are helping me go live. And I'm thankful for all the teachers who have given me this knowledge. I'm thankful for this shelter that I have. I can go on, you know. There's a lot of things that we need to be thankful for. Relaxation techniques. Now, gratitude, I think I've made myself clear. Moving on to relaxation technique. Now, this is not something that we can do at the moment when we are angry. This is something that we have to do when, we have to imbibe into our daily routine. Every day we have to do this. Certain techniques of mindfulness can be used. Mindfulness does involve grounding techniques, breathing exercises, maybe coloring, maybe reading something, anything that brings you to the moment. A very famous technique for mindfulness, for grounding technique, is the 5-4-3-2-1 technique, where you can look at five things around you. Whatever you see, you have to observe that. Four things you can feel, like the skin, whatever you feel on your skin, your feet on the ground. Three things that you can smell or hear. Three things that you can hear, two things you can smell, and one thing you can taste. Now, this is 5-4-3-2-1 technique. It's a very well-known technique for grounding, being in the moment. And that is what mindfulness is all about. Being present in this moment at this time. Another thing could be praying. A lot of us can feel connected and more positive by praying. If you're somebody who likes praying, should definitely do it on a daily basis. Progressive muscular relaxation is a kind of body scan technique that we do to relax each and every muscle of your body. Now, this can be done more than twice, thrice in a day, depending on your routine. This basically starts from our toes. We consciously make an effort to relax each and every body part, and it goes all the way up to our head. Another technique that we can practice on a daily basis is asking for what exactly you need and saying things in a I feel sentence. For example, someone on an everyday basis may say things like, you never understand me, I feel you're not listening. So instead of that, you can say that I feel you're not listening to me when you don't let me finish my sentence. Now, what happens over here is, instead of putting the blame on the opposite person, you are expressing what exactly you need. That is, you are saying that the person is unable, not allowing you to finish your sentence. And thus, you may feel like you are not, they are not listening to you. Now, this puts a different perspective in front of the person, thus preventing an argument to begin with. So get in the habit of doing this on a daily basis. But instead of saying, you know what, you don't do this, say that I feel like this when this is not happening. Or instead, you know, and ask for exactly what you need. This can really prevent conflicts from happening, and thus anger can be managed. When it comes to patient care and caregiver's point of view, there will be a lot of moments in your life that can be managed better when we start using these kind of sentences. Another technique is the self-talk. Now we all as human beings, we have evolved over years to come till here, something called as a metacognition, where we are aware about our own thought process. It's kind of an we all, our mind never is quiet, right? There's always something or the other going on in our mind. We have this inner dialogue that's always ongoing, a kind of self-talk. It's as if, you know, it's a movie, it's always running in your mind. You're always having some thoughts, some things that you're thinking about. Your mind can never be idle, right? So now this inner dialogue that you have, it takes a little time to identify, which comes under the metacognition aspect, is to be aware of our own thoughts. These inner dialogues that you're having, I want you to identify about the theme of these inner dialogue. There might be certain thoughts that are coming more regularly in your brain, in your mind, I'm sorry. And, you know, these things could be about yourself, about the others around you, about your future. What kind of thoughts do you often get? Try and analyze it. It's not a one-day job. It's something that we have to do on a daily basis. Try and record it somewhere so that it's easier for you to find a pattern in your own self-talk. Now ask if these inner dialogues or these self-talk that you've been having that are repetitive in nature, whether they are helpful or not. Is this thought really helping me go ahead in life? Is this thought really letting me enjoy my life at the fullest? Try and challenge any unhelpful thought that you can identify. If you think certain thoughts are preventing you from being your best, try and challenge them. Why should we work on our own thoughts? Why should we work on our own self-talk and the inner dialogue? It's very well portrayed by this beautiful story that I've heard about. Everyone must be aware, you must have seen elephant. Now elephants, when they are young, are tied with this rope, okay, a small rope. The same elephant is tied with the same rope even when it grows up, even when it is an adult. Now what has happened is, this elephant believes, an adult elephant believes, that because from young age I've been tied to this rope is enough to hold me back. Now over here, the elephant's thought is that, this rope is enough to hold me back and it can really stop me from escaping. And it believes in it, so it follows it. Similarly, in a lot of different events in our life, you must have identified certain beliefs that can be limiting us. I want you to identify those thoughts. If they are more negative thoughts, try to bring it to neutral. And if they are neutral thoughts, try to bring it to your positive thoughts. Another story over here that I would like to share is of this tribal people, who are settled across certain continents, still use primitive method for farming. So when they go from one patch of land to another patch of land, they have to clear that place for their agricultural needs. Now these tribal people are not advanced more, so they do not have access to all these materials that we have access to now in farming. So what they do is, they have to clear a patch of land, and if there is any tree over there, they go early in the morning over there every day, and they use a lot of negative words and a lot of bad things they say to the tree. Okay, they do this every day. Eventually, within weeks, the whole humongous tree also withers away. Now something as big and huge as a tree can get affected with positive and negative energy or the talk that we have with it. We are human beings. So we have to be very careful about what kind of inner dialogue and self-talk we have with ourselves. Example of a kind of negative thought that an individual with who is diagnosed with MND may have is that I'm dependent on my family members, thus I'm a burden. If you have to really challenge this thought, we could modify into or reframe these sentence, this sentence into I have a supportive family who are always there by me. Now what happens is, you're still talking about your family being there for you, but you're looking at it in a more neutral or a more positive outlook. This removes anger from within. Catharsis is another technique where you have to talk it out, whatever your feelings are, whatever your thoughts are, whatever your emotions are, with somebody you really believe in. With some friends of yours, maybe your family members or your caregivers, or maybe your first line of physicians that you interact with on a regular basis. Talk it out. When you talk it out, you feel better. You feel like you have shared your burden with someone. The journey is difficult. The journey can be really overwhelming. But using some of these techniques can help it more easier or a little better, or can really help you manage it better. Visualization is another technique that you can use. Visualization can be practiced on a daily basis. This is basically a technique wherein, being in the moment, you can visit a place of your favorite place through imagination, through imagery, and experience that moment. Now, this can be done after you have had an anger outburst maybe already. And you can, whatever thoughts and emotions that are associated with that moment, with that situation, you can let go of. I would like to demonstrate a little bit of visualization today over here. Just give me a minute while I set it up. I want you all to sit comfortably, relax your body, keep your feet on the ground, okay? And you can close your eyes. Listen to what I have to say. Imagine yourself completely relaxed. Now I want you to imagine of any moment or event in your life that made you very angry, really angry, where your scale, you would mark that moment, that event as 10. I want you to recollect that incident, event or moment. Now imagine, while you're imagining all that, just while you are recollecting those events, I want you to imagine walking through some stairs. Through some stairs, you are going down, you are going down, and you are walking down, going downstairs, through the stairs. It looks like a lighthouse, a stone lighthouse. And then you can hear, as you are going more closer to the ground level, you are hearing some water sounds. You are walking out of the lighthouse to find yourself this beautiful, breathtaking white sand beach with a blue water. And as far as your eyes can see, you're seeing this beautiful sea and the sand, and there is no human being around. It's you and your thoughts. It's you all by yourself in this beach. Now imagine all the thoughts of anger that you were carrying. It is in a backpack, and now you're taking this backpack into the beach. You go a little further. Now you're walking slowly. You feel the ocean coming and touching your feet, and it's going back. The waves are coming in and going back. You continue to walk along the beach. Now you're getting a little tired because you're carrying all this bag, right? This bag has all the events, all the emotions that you were really angry about. You go a little ahead and you find a beautiful bench just laid out for you. Now this bench is right under the coconut tree. It's well, you know, there's enough shade for you to sit and relax over there. I want you to sit over there for some time. You're sitting over there and relaxing. You're trying to recollect what happened in that moment that induced all that anger that you experienced. Take a few minutes to think about it. Take a few minutes to recollect all these emotions that went out of hand, the anger that you experienced, the same words or certain things that you did that you normally wouldn't do. And then you are ready, because you want to relax further. I want you to pick up this bag, walk towards the beach. Just when you're ready, you can throw it into the water. When we throw something into the beach, the waves bring it forward and they take it back little by little. So as each and every wave comes and goes, you see your bag coming a little ahead and going further and further away from you. You're standing there where the waves are crashing on your feet, and you're watching your bag being carried away further, far away from you, really far away, that you can't see it anymore. And you feel this lightness in your mind and in your body. That bag that was making you angry, or these thoughts that were preventing you from being emotionally that regulated, is gone now. So you feel this lightness in your mind or in your body. So you decide to walk. Just decide to walk. Now your walk will have a sprint, because there is no bag weighing you down. Imagine walking till wherever or for how long you want to walk. Or you could sit back and relax on that bench. And when you are ready, and when you feel that you're completely relaxed from that moment, I want you to take a walk back to where we began from. You start walking back. Now the sun is setting. Now it's time to return home. So you slowly walk back. The birds are flying back to their home now. It's evening. So you're walking back. You enter the same lighthouse that you left a few hours back. You're climbing up the stairs again. Bring your awareness to wherever you're sitting now. Now it's time to recollect all those memories. Keep it in your memory. All these wonderful experiences that you had at that beach. And it's time to be back again in your seat. And when you're ready, you can slowly open your eyes. Enjoy this lightness in your mind and in your body. You can take a sip of water and carry on. And that's one example of how visualization can work. Now this, when we practice on a regular basis, we are letting go of certain things that could be holding us back, certain thoughts, certain feelings. certain events that were beyond our control. So it helps you to relax at that moment and to have a better perspective towards that situation. It can go as long and as short as you want. It's ideal if you do it with somebody who's experienced in doing it, or you take some tips and techniques before you start doing visualizations. And remember that you're important and your life counts. So if anything gets overwhelming for you, if you feel you need to discuss with somebody, we are always there for you. Seek professional help, seek professional mental health, people to get any kind of further assistance that you need in case you feel all of this is overwhelming for you. Thank you so much.